The following previews are of graphic audio productions rated for mature audiences due to scenes of intense violence and sexual situations.
If you dialed correctly, you know my name. Speak.
Mistress.
All is well, I trust.
Yes. We had an accident this evening.
You must tell me all about it. In person.
I would be delighted. Shall I bring something?
Bring your obedience worm.
Do we have a crisis?
Mr. President, we appear to have a foreign submarine operating off New England. It may be interfering with commercial fishing.
Did you say fishing?
Yes. You are aware of the fishing crisis.
In New York, UN Secretary General Anwar Sadat has made a claim that is creating quite a stir in diplomatic circles. It seems, according to the Secretary General, that a U.S. Coast Guard cutter and a submarine suspected to be of Canadian origin, French-Canadian origin to be precise, clashed in disputed waters on the Grand Banks, with the result that the sub was sunk with all hands aboard. It is a sign that individual nations cannot be trusted to oversee their own territorial waters, and that a UN High Commission should be established to patrol and safeguard the high seas. Mr. Sadat claims that such patrols would serve to protect the much overfished stocks that are the cause of so much international friction these days.
Mr. President, I am very distressed by the friction between your nation and the Canadians.
I could use your help.
It is a consequence, I think, of the extension of the 200-mile limits and the fierce quest for diminishing fish. As the leader of the former free world, I must ask you to reconsider your 200-mile limit.
Reconsider it how?
Roll it back. Unilaterally. If you make this gesture, other nations may follow your lead. Then the international waters will be truly free again.
The world's ears are turned in your direction, my Anwar.
Although my duty calls for me to be here, I will come to your city wherever it may be.
Ottawa, come tonight.
We will laugh, we will dance, and we will dine on one another's charms.
And we will confer with the Canadian Minister of Fisheries.
Both schemes are mine. Now they are one. You have both worked my will in the world. Now you will work together.
What exactly are your goals?
To plunge the world into the Red Abyss. Who is this who invades my domain?
Who is this who demands such answers of us?
I am Mistress Kali.
If you are Mistress Kali, then you will recognize my companion, who is sometimes called Shiva the Destroyer.
The Destroyer, number 106, Whitewater, is available now on graphic audio. Don't be surprised if you get hooked.
Do you desire to enter into the presence of Mistress Kali?
Eagles 8, Blood of Eagles. The Oklahoma Panhandle is 100 miles of lawlessness and danger, a no man's land designed to separate Texas from pro-Union Kansas. Through this desolate strip rides legendary gunslinger Falcon McAllister with a 12-year-old Indian boy by his side. Behind them lies a scene of horror left by a band of outlaws who've murdered the boy's parents and massacred the settlers of a small wagon train. And the list of atrocities doesn't end there.
What did you call me? Did you call me crazy?
Come on, Billy. Back off. It's just a way of talking. Damned if you ain't the contrariest critter I ever seen.
You know who used to call me Crazy Tuck? My mother did. My own mother. Can you beat that? The old bitch said I was crazy as a loon. Just like you said a time or two.
Well, I'm sorry, Billy, but I...
Do you know what I did when I heard that too much, Tuck? She said that one too many times. And I took a strop knife to her. I knocked her down, then I busted open her jaw, and I cut out her damn tongue.
You killed her? You killed your own mother?
Hell no, I didn't. I let her do that herself.
As they search the panhandle for the killers, Falcon and Wahatli enter a storm of greed, thievery, and betrayal that has its roots in two long, gleaming bands of steel. A new railway is penetrating this hostile land, meaning riches to some and death to many. Into this maelstrom ride a boy and a gunfighter on their own brutal search for retribution.
Falcon! Behind you on the roof!
Falcon ducked and turned, feeling a jab of lingering pain as his .44 came up. A man with a yellow sash pitched head first from the roof of the old trading post. Falcon was past the big wagon when some impulse made him turn and duck. There in the street, rising out of the settling dust, was a man as big as Falcon himself, a man with a smoking gun in his hand. Falcon dodged, tumbled, and rolled, and the pain in his middle became a living thing. Two more bullets kicked up dirt beside him, and he rolled again, coming up on his elbows to return fire. The specter in the dust dodged wildly and ran. In an instant, he was out of sight behind the wagon. Falcon came to his feet, advancing. A broken-down trough hid the underside of the wagon, and he started around it, then doubled back and went the other way. Asa Parker was waiting for him, crouched in shadows behind a tall wheel. He held a ready .45 and leaned outward, ready to shoot the instant Falcon cleared the water trough. Falcon circled around the lashed-up tongue and stepped past the iron tire of the all-four wheel.
Time's up, Parker. Colorado or die.
The glory and danger of the Wild West live on in Eagles number 8, Blood of Eagles.
And now, for our feature presentation. Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Mr. Murakami was completely lost. The gray and blue clouds hanging low over their rented minivan were suddenly veined with lightning. The vehicle's interior flashed blue-white. It might have been the judgment of the Kami, alien spirits of an alien place.
This is the desert. It isn't supposed to rain.
Although from his studies, he knew that it did rain in the desert. Rarely, but violently. There was no denying a deluge was in the offing. He could smell the rain and the ozone, overlying the sage and dust of the deceptively flat-looking khaki terrain of the Acoma Indian Reservation. Obsessed enthusiast that he was for the history and culture of the southwestern United States, so different from his grim industrial suburb outside Tokyo, Mr. Murakami should have been in heaven. Instead, he was peeved.
That poor child! We should stop and pick her up!
Mrs. Murakami looked imploringly at her husband.
What child?
That child! Hurry! It's about to rain!
He looked the way his wife's sturdy arm pointed.
A child? What can she be doing here?
She stood in the clumpy weeds by the side of the rough dirt track. She wore a sort of blue dress with a scarlet cape around her shoulders, pinned off center with a gold clamshell brooch. Small pink feet in sandals poked out beneath the hem of the robe. She had a plump, round face, framed by flowing brown locks, spilling from either side of a hat with an astonishing plume and the brim pinned up in front. The children, Taro and Hanako, looked up from their furious head-to-head battle on their video game.
A little girl!
Can we pick her up? Can we, Daddy?
We have to! She'll wash away!
They had reservations at the Old Town Hotel in Albuquerque for 5 that afternoon. Mr. Murakami knew that they could be in trouble if they missed their reservation, but he was a stranger in a strange land. They had driven through mountains with pine trees, almost like home, between Gallup and Grants. But somewhere south of US 40, they'd found themselves stuck in the middle of a vast bowl of desert, rimmed by wind-scalloped mesas. His wife hopped out into a barrage of raindrops. She opened the sliding side door of the van.
What's she doing out here?
We saved her! We're heroes! Yay!
With Mrs. Murakami's help, the child stepped into the van. Startled, Mr. Murakami realized it was a boy.
Shh! You're okay now. You're fine. Mommy's got you.
Thank you, honored sir, for stopping to pick me up.
The Murakami children slid the door shut as their mother returned to her seat hastily. Taro and Hanako helped him buckle himself in the seat between them. Gently but firmly, he insisted on keeping his staff tucked in a crook of his gowned arm, at a sort of angle to fit the roof. Murakami started to drive again. He felt a rising urgency. He perceived America as a violent land, but had not expected that might extend to its very environment. The growing fury of the lightning and thunder so unsettled him that he had a hard time preserving his stoic demeanor. Away off to the left, he could see the looming sandstone mesa on which an ancient city rested. Its somewhat brutal blockiness was softened by veils of rain that threatened to mask it from view entirely. His objective in driving into this lunar wilderness was the real Sky City on its majestic rock slab, the oldest continuously inhabited settlement in North America. People had dwelt up there, over 300 feet above the surrounding land, since sometime before the 12th century. If only he could figure out how to get to the confounded hill. Through the rain, Murakami could hear his children trying to share their handheld games with their new passenger. His wife had turned around in her seat to face the boy.
Where are you from, child? Where are your parents?
Murakami was creeping along. He was genuinely afraid he and his family and their peculiar guest would be swept away at any moment by the horrible, ferocious weather. He tried desperately to remember if tornadoes hit this part of the U.S.
Honored sir.
Murakami drove across a low rise and began to descend. 100 yards ahead, the road bottomed, passing through a gulch with sheer, high walls scooped out of the hard earth. Beyond it rose the flank of yet another ridge. He wished his budget had permitted a rental with GPS.
Please.
What is it?
You must not go down there, Sensei.
The child had called him Master.
How does the boy know Japanese customs?
But what other way can I go?
You must turn around back the way you came. If you do, you will find a dirt road 1.5 miles on the right. It is hard to see, but you will find it. When you take that, it will bring you shortly to a paved road. That will take you where you need to go.
Murakami scowled. If the confounded road was there, how had they missed it? The child didn't even know their destination. He shook his head.
I don't want to turn back. Surely, if we keep going this way, we shall get there.
The truth was, he was afraid to go back, but he would never admit that aloud.
Sensei, please, your danger is very great if you proceed down this road.
I think you should listen to him.
Yes, Daddy, listen to him, please.
Frowning furiously, Murakami brought the van to a stop halfway down to the gully.
All right, but
Daddy!
The children flew from their seats to plaster themselves against the passenger side window.
Look!
Down the narrow gully from the right came something that turned Murakami's blood to ice. A wall of water, frothing dirty white. A tsunami in miniature, 6 or 7 yards wide and 2 yards tall, rushed toward them. He saw with instant, horrible clarity what would have happened had he driven on. The wall of water would have caught the minivan, tumbled it downstream like a toy, until it battered open a window and the turbulent water smashed in to drown his entire family. Murakami and his family watched the flash flood sweep past. It made a roiled river of the road in front of them.
You are safe now, but your world also faces terrible danger. Please heed that warning too.
Yes, yes. I thank you.
Daddy!
The seat was empty. The child was gone.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Rogue Angel number 4, The Chosen. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Terence Aselford, Richard Rowan, David Coyne, Ken Jackson, James Konicek, James Lewis, Karen Carbone, Thomas Penny, Sonny Lasskey, Christopher Graybill, Cate, Torre, Patrick Rabe, Chris Rowan, Nathanial Perry, Bobby Aselford, and Mort Shelby.
Hey, Anya, come over here a sec.
The wiry, red-bearded man in the white straw cowboy hat stood to his faded denim-clad hips in a 15-by-15-foot hole scraped out of the scrub-dotted chaparral of the Española Valley, about 10 miles north of Santa Fe, New Mexico. The sun looked like a big red balloon about to pop itself on the peaks of the Jemez. Annja Creed swallowed the last of the water from the cooler settled on the lowered tailgate of what Max Leland, professor of archaeology at the University of New Mexico and dig leader, called his pick-em-up truck. She set the speckled blue metal mug marked with her name on the scuffed black bedliner and walked over, drying her hands on the rump of her brown jeans. She walked along the lip of the dig, trimmed with tough blue grama grass. Like much of New Mexico, the soil was hard clay. Annja was not ashamed to admit that she was glad to have missed the drudgery of excavating the site in the brutal summer sun. It didn't get all that hot up here, and there wasn't any humidity to speak of. But above 7,000 feet, the sun was much stronger than what she was used to at sea level. Even though the temperature was only in the low 60s, Annja could feel the ultraviolet rays sizzling on her skin. Max boosted himself to sit on the edge of the hole.
Check this out.
He held up a Ziploc bag. She squatted next to him, squinting at the scalloped chips of pale stone. They had an almost translucent quality in the dying daylight. The dense overcast, like a ceiling set ablaze by the sunset, gave the light a texture she could almost feel, but did little to aid her vision.
Flint flakes. Someone's been napping.
He nodded, beaming. In archaeology circles, Max Leland enjoyed modest renown as a flint napper and general expert on the subject of making things from flint. He gestured into the flat-bottomed oblong hole at his feet.
Found him right here, not too far from where the front door used to be. Looks like the inhabitants of this house were rolling their own tools up to the middle of the 19th century.
You racist!
They both whipped around. An angry young Latina with long black hair stood right behind them, shaking a finger at the sunburned tip of Leland's nose.
What?
You heard me. You can't say that about my people.
Say what, Yvonne?
I didn't say anything offensive. I'm just showing Annja what I found.
But it must have been left here by Indians long before the house was built.
The professor's face was turning even redder beneath his tan.
Now listen, I thought all this got settled years ago.
All right, everybody. Just hold on there.
Everyone turned. Trish Donnelly, a graduate assistant, and Allison Simpson, an undergrad, approached. They had been loading gear into a second pickup when the dispute broke out. Yvonne Gonzalez, the girl making the accusation, was a freshman from Las Vegas, just over the mountains to the east.
He's accusing my people of being savages. He claims they used stone tools like cavemen.
Trish put herself between the combatants.
Wait. Here.
She took hold of Yvonne's upper arm. Yvonne tried to resist, but Trish Donnelly was built like a harbor tug and was about as easy to resist.
Come on, Yvonne.
Annja had known her for years. Trish had invited her to spend the past 2 weeks on the dig and wangled permissions from Leland and the San Ezequiel Pueblos, who owned the land. In all that time, she had never heard the woman raise her voice, not even in a bar fight.
We're gonna talk. Annja, why don't you come too?
How about me, Trish?
Allison was a willowy Dartmouth blonde from upstate New York.
You stay here, honey. Keep Professor Max from spontaneously combusting.
I am not spontaneously combusting!
She's a sweet child, Annja, but far too innocent for archaeology.
These Tejanos are all alike.
Yvonne was still trying to hang back. She reminded Annja of a child balking when a nun was trying to take her somewhere.
She's like me.
Annja had always had a problem with authority herself. Growing up under the iron regime of the nuns in an orphanage in New Orleans had hardened rather than softened her resistant nature. Still, in their brief association, she'd never found Leland remotely authoritarian, or racist for that matter.
Damn it, I'm from West Virginia!
Trish marched her little party up to the top of the rise. The clearing went on for 10 or 15 more yards, then rose into some woods of serious pine trees. Not the scruffy, hunchbacked pinyons that dotted most of the rolling landscape for miles around. Trish stopped, turned Yvonne to face her, and released her arm.
Now, Yvonne, what exactly is your major malfunction?
He was trying to say the people who lived in this house napped flint.
And did he have any evidence to back that up?
Well, he dug up some flint flakes, but they couldn't have anything to do with the people who lived here. They must have been from long before.
Think, Yvonne. They were found at the same level as artifacts we've definitely dated from the 1850s. We have the land records. The Tejada and then the Dominguin families lived here from 1701 until the house burned down in 1863. How could Indian artifacts from some earlier time period have gotten mixed up with stuff from a century and a half after the house was built?
Maybe kids dug them up.
The point is, where do you think you get off calling Leland a racist? That's a serious accusation. He could lose his job. Shit, maybe go to jail the way things are these days.
But it's like he was saying my people were savages, just like—
What?
Who's being racist now, Yvonne?
Yvonne deflated in a hurry. She wasn't stupid, far from it. But Annja had noticed she had a tendency to be reactive and defensive. While polite enough, the young Latina had acted wary of Annja since her arrival. She hadn't opened up, but Annja guessed she had some unresolved cultural conflicts going on that made her touchy.
But...
Yvonne let that drop, too. She realized, now the moment's heat had cooled, that she had wandered out of bounds.
Lighten up, sweetie. It's been a long season, and the clock says it's time to go. We're all a little frazzled, a little weird.
Annja saw Yvonne blinking tears from her eyes as Trish pulled the young woman into a hug. She understood. She hadn't had time to really become part of this crew, yet she, too, felt the camaraderie that arose from long, hard hours spent working to a common purpose. What these women were feeling, she knew from experience, was much more poignant.
Will I ever really know that feeling again? Or have I lost that part of my life forever?
She was starting to feel half misty herself. Between her semi-regular gig with the hit cable channel show Chasing History's Monsters and her apparent destiny, she wasn't really in position to commit herself to a full season in the field. She saw Yvonne's eyes suddenly go wide.
Oh my God!
Trish's shoulders tensed. Annja felt her own chestnut hair rise at the nape of her neck below her sleek ponytail. Slowly, she turned. There was a figure standing among the trees. It looked like a tall man in a dark cloak. Annja had the sense he was staring at her. She felt intent so malign it made her knees weak. She shook her head.
Am I hallucinating or what?
Trish disengaged herself from the smaller woman and turned to face the intruder, her bulldog jaw squared.
Can we help you? Listen, Buster.
Annja waved a hand from her hip in a calming gesture. Soft-spoken and generally easygoing though she was, Trish didn't have the longest fuse.
I don't know what game you think you're playing.
Two red glows appeared from the stranger's shadowed black head.
Jesu Christo!
Yvonne crossed herself.
Yvonne! Trish! Are you guys all right?
Holy shit.
Her hand dived inside her dirt-caked coveralls and came out holding a flat black pistol. Darkness unfolded from the mystery figure's sides. At first, Annja thought it was a cape.
Halloween's almost a month away, and this jackass is about to play Dracula to the point of getting shot.
But it wasn't a cape. Black, tapering wings spread wider than the man was tall. Annja felt her right hand start to curl as if to grab something.
No, it isn't time.
Yvonne had peeled off her knapsack and was rummaging furiously inside.
Whoa!
Leland leapt off the tailgate, ran to the front of the truck, and yanked open the door so hard it banged against the stops. Yvonne pulled a Glock 19 out to the full length of her arms in a two-handed grip. She was trembling so violently, the gun's blunt muzzle waved wildly. The figure rose straight into the air. The black wings never stirred. At 20 feet, it leveled out and glided over their heads with silent purpose. Leland had popped out of the truck cab, working the lever action of a .44 Magnum Marlin Model 94 carbine. The huge black creature swooped toward him. It passed 10 feet over the top of his and Allison's heads. Leland's face went so pale it was green. He had not been able to bring himself to raise the gun. The black figure soared upward to clear a juniper-dotted ridge 100 yards away and vanished. Large snowflakes began to fall. Allison threw herself on the ground and covered her head with her hands.
Oh my God, they had guns.
Annja let out the breath she had not realized she was holding. Trish came up beside her and rested her right elbow on Anya's shoulder. Her pistol dangled from her hand.
Wow.
What was that? What was it?
Thankfully, Yvonne was pointing her own handgun toward the clouds, now bluish black. The sun had vanished from sight, leaving a lemon glow around the Hames peaks.
A bird? Eagles have surprisingly wide wingspans.
Do eagles have red freaking eyes?
Maybe the sunlight reflected...
She gave it up. She didn't believe it, much as she wanted to. Trish put her pistol back wherever it came from.
What's with all the swamp gas? With that show you're on, I figure you'd be, you know, on the other side and all.
I'm kind of the reality anchor. You're a scientist, Trish. What else could it be?
I've also been hiking the Southwest most of my life. Be real, Annja. That was an eagle like I'm Mary Kate Olsen.
What was it then?
I'm afraid to find out.
Down the hill, Allison rolled frantically away from Leland when he knelt next to her to see what was wrong. He held the marlin pointed skyward in one hand.
Don't touch me!
Yvonne had regained control of herself and zipped her Glock back into her pack. Aside from high color in her cinnamon cheeks and slightly flared nostrils, she didn't look as if much out of the ordinary had happened. It made Annja wonder. Outsiders told strange stories of happenings where Yvonne came from, way up in the Blood of Christ Mountains.
What's wrong with her?
Easterner.
The wind from the glacier gorge whipped mist into the fat man's bearded face like ice-laden fronds. The sky above was crowded with clouds, their gray, gravid bellies hanging almost close enough to touch.
A storm is coming. How appropriate.
Monsignor Paolo Benigni checked the Rolex watch strapped to his wrist. Next to the black of his overcoat, his skin looked bluish-white.
Where is the man? It's almost time, and I see no sign of him.
The railed scenic viewpoint overlooking the Reichenbach Falls was deserted except for the fat man and his two younger, much larger companions. October's arrival a few days earlier had brought the annual closing of the funicular that carried tourists from the valley floor to just below the mighty falls themselves. A safe distance back from the sheer cliffs, the hotel in the village was temporarily closed for renovation. Actually, it had closed at the special request of a man whose influence reached to the core of the Vatican itself. The public was scarcely aware of the name of Monsignor Benigni, but people who counted, the people who really ran the world, knew his name very well indeed. To his intense annoyance, he found himself compelled to meet here with an impudent bastard, a mere priest. A priest without a flock, and a damned black Jesuit on top of that. Yet Benigni knew this disciple of the long-dead Basque madman Loyola had an influence that was scarcely less shadowy or pervasive than the Monsignor's own.
Well, today we shall settle that account.
There were many in the Vatican who would thank him for his resolution of this turbulent priest.
Monsignor.
Volker, the German bodyguard, peered over the railing above the precipice. He had a lantern jaw fringed with blue-black beard. His pinstriped suit was tailored so immaculately that no seam showed the least sign of strain around his vast powerlifter's bulk. Not even at the left armpit, where a Walther P99 was nestled in a shoulder holster.
What is it?
Perhaps you should come see, Excellency.
Grimacing in annoyance, the Monsignor waddled to the edge. His face sank deep into his own neatly bearded chins as he leaned over slightly, all he could readily manage. A path wound up the cold granite cliff from the notch where white waters arced down to the River Inn far below. Seemingly out of the fall's very mist came a solitary figure, trotting up the steps with unnatural vigor. The figure wore a long black coat. The head of silver-gray hair was bare.
What's doing it the hard way?
Samo, the Samoan, was even bigger and broader than Volker, with a mass of crinkly black hair held back from his great, tanned face in a braid.
The fool. Still, If he wishes to exhaust himself in this manner, let him. He will have ample time to rest soon enough.
The Monsignor pushed away from the white-painted steel rail with a ringed and exquisitely manicured pale hand. The height and sheerness of the drop made him uneasy. All this cavorting about in nature was foreign to his constitution. He preferred a leather chair in some five-star hotel, basking in the warmth of a fire and a snifter of brandy. Benigni thought about what the immediate future held in store for the vexatious Father Robert Godin, Societas Jesu, who was responsible for dragging him out in this frightful weather. He smiled with lips moist, full and reddish purple within his goatee. Godin trotted onto the top of the cliff and slowed to a walk while approaching the waiting trio. He had his hands in the pockets of his black trench coat. His breathing seemed normal and his step springy. The Monsignor might have suspected the man had a pact with the devil, but he knew better.
Monsignor.
Father.
He extended a hand. Godin shook it. Although he exerted no more than brief, firm pressure, it was like gripping a vise. With the ease of long practice, Benigni masked his irritation. As an assistant chamberlain of the Vatican, Benigni was entitled to have his ring kissed. He was also accustomed to it. But the Jesuit has never been born who would bend the knee to less than a red hat, he told himself, and Benigni had purposely avoided becoming a cardinal. Dressing all in scarlet made it harder to operate properly in the shadows, where his most important work was done.
What exigency drove you to request this urgent conference, Father Godin? Or should I say, Father Bob?
Godin smiled, but briefly. He was 62 years of age, the same height as Benigni, but half the weight. He looked like an extremely fit man a decade younger, and moved, the Monsignor had to admit resentfully to himself, like a fine athlete. His hair was gray, buzzed to white sidewalls and a silvery flat top. His face was oblong and deeply creased, the only sign of age he showed aside from the hue of his hair. His eyes, behind circular wire-rimmed spectacles, were the palest, most piercing green.
I've come to discuss retirement.
You? The last knight in armor? Or should I say, the last inquisitor? Are you ready to hang up the spurs, or perhaps the scourge?
Yours, Monsignor.
Mind your manners, priest.
I don't care about your peculations or your secular crimes, Monsignor. I don't care about your involvement in the murder of Roberto Calvi in 1982, nor your dealings with the outlawed propaganda Du Masonic Lodge. I don't care what deals you worked with the late Archbishop Marcinkus.
Benigni had gone very pale.
Old man, you overreach yourself.
But when your self-indulgence leads you to invoke demons, entailing the sacrifice of a human life, then, Monsignor Benigni, you fall within my bailiwick.
You have no proof.
The creases of the bloodhound face deepened in a grin. He tapped first his temple, then his heart.
All the proof I need I have in here. And if I am satisfied, the church is satisfied.
Absurd! You hurl accusations at random. You're a madman.
Brother Luigi confessed, Monsignor. In Verona, he is now in custody. Your agents will prove unable to locate or silence him. He will live out his years in silent repentance. His testimony, however, has been duly recorded and notarized. Should it prove necessary, I don't doubt several other of your confederates can be prevailed upon to testify, but with the videotapes in our possession...
My attorneys will laugh these accusations out of court.
Unlikely, were it to go to trial, especially in some of the nations that have jurisdiction in the case. But there will be no trial, Monsignor. I am authorized to offer you the opportunity to resign your offices and rank and retire to a monastery outside Addis Ababa.
Ethiopia? But they are Copts.
No longer. They call their schismatic church Ethiopian Orthodox now. But as you would know, were you properly attentive to your duties, Monsignor Benigni, the Ethiopian Catholic Church remains communicant with our Holy Father. They are holy men. They'll ensure you are cared for and protect you diligently from the temptations of this world.
Benigni stared at Gaudin with eyes like boiled eggs. Then he looked down at the gray stone beneath the mirror-polished black toes of his Gucci shoes. It was polished almost smooth by generations of tourist feet, slicked by mist from below and snow from above.
She was just a whore.
Even a whore has a right to live her life and not be tortured out of it. Even a whore has an immortal soul. Or do you speak of what you tried to make of her mother, the church?
You dare to speak so to me, who bathed your arms in the gore of innocence in the Congo?
Anyone whose blood I may have bathed in, Monsignor, was hardly an innocent. But the sins that stain my soul are not under discussion here.
I anticipated you might attempt some such quixotry, Father Gaudin. So I came prepared.
He gestured to the two huge bodyguards who stood flanking them.
As I said before, Father, you will be retiring today. Volker and Semo will assist you. In the mist and the snow, these steps up the precipice are so treacherous. Alas, you insisted on climbing alone despite the conditions.
The two bodyguards stepped forward. Gaudin moved to meet Semo, who approached from his right. Volker reached for him from behind. Gaudin stopped, spun back, and seized the German's thick wrist with his right hand. He dropped his left elbow over the elbow of the trapped arm and pivoted clockwise.
Kill him! Kill him now!
Samo's bronze face had gone ashen at the brutal abruptness with which his partner's arm was snapped. From beneath his jacket, he produced an MP5K. He yanked back on the trigger and held it down. Volker's Kevlar vest kept the 9mm bullets from penetrating, but ribs cracked and the breath was forced from his lungs. Then a bullet hit the German in the throat. Blood spurted in a single thick stream. It gleamed almost black in the faint light. Holding Volker propped against him, with his own legs braced, Father Gaudin thrust a CZ-75 under the mortally wounded man's arm and shot Samo twice in his broad chest. The Samoan's vest stopped the slugs. The Jesuit's third shot struck Samo in the center of the forehead. Gaudin stepped back. Volker simply slumped and pitched forward on his face. Snow began to fall in earnest. Fat white flakes filled the air, thick as flies on a midsummer evening. The Jesuit tucked his Czech handgun back inside his coat.
And now, Monsignor.
You devil!
Benigni put his head down and charged. He was out of shape. He could barely walk across a room without panting. But he weighed over 300 pounds, and a surge of adrenaline lent strength to atrophied muscles. His momentum drove the older, lighter man to slam his lower back cruelly against the metal rail. Benigni's arms held Gaudin's trapped to his sides in a bear hug. His own strength surprised him. His forehead smeared the Monsignor's broad nose across much of his pie plate face. Pain shot through Benigni's brain and eyes like an inquisitor's red-hot pokers. Tears streamed down his cheeks, hot as the blood that poured across and into his mouth and down his chin. He felt the smaller man's body like a bundle of wire and steel rods, stooping down. Felt hard hands dig into the backs of his thighs. Then, the prelate felt himself deadlifted. The soles of his Gucci shoes lost contact with the slick granite. Holding Benigni's soft, yielding bulk over his right shoulder like a sack of meal, Gaudin straightened his legs, upending the Monsignor. Gaudin watched as the Monsignor vanished from sight in the mist that boiled from the falls. He put his hands to the small of his back and stretched his body backward. He was capable of deadlifting far more than the obese prelate's weight, and had used proper form. But his muscles were not so durable as they once were. Then he doubled over. The coughing brought Father Gaudin almost to his knees. He hung onto the rail until the fit passed. He dabbed moistness from his mouth with a handkerchief. He put it away without looking at it.
One more job done. Doubtless two more will spring up in his place. Yet I can only do what one man can in the service of our Lord.
He checked his wristwatch, then turned and walked briskly toward the hotel and the highway. He had a flight to catch from Zurich back to Rome and a discreet rendezvous where he expected to receive the assignment that would cap his long, illustrious career.
Then I will have truly earned my rest. But will I be allowed to take it?
The lobby of the new Ramada Inn on the south side of the small Española Valley town of Pohake was decorated in what Annja had come to think of as Southwest typical. Rounded, whitewashed forms hinted at adobe brick beneath, no matter what was really there. Rich colored tile and brass and smoked mirror trimming were offset by the occasional horsetail fern accent. It actually produced a pleasant, calming effect, even if it had become something of a design cliché. As Annja entered the lobby, the receptionist beckoned her over.
Ms. Creed, I'm afraid we can't give you an option to renew your room after your reservation runs out the day after tomorrow.
Really? Why not?
We've had a run of new bookings. I'm afraid we've committed all of our rooms.
Is something happening at one of the casinos?
The local pueblos, clustered thickly in the fertile upper Rio Grande Valley, had already constructed several casinos, giant pyramids of neon and more faux adobe.
Oh no, they're pilgrims and paranormal investigators. They're here about the Santo Niño.
Santo Niño?
It means holy child.
I see.
It's all over the internet. There have been sightings here for weeks. People have gotten really excited.
Who or what is this holy child?
He's a little boy who appears standing by the roadside. He looks 8 or 10. He's wearing some kind of funny clothes. They say totally 16th century Spanish or something. People feel sorry for him and pick him up. He thanks them and warns them something terrible is about to happen. Then he vanishes. I even read that a Japanese family picked him up a couple of days ago.
Huh. Well, at least it's my room for a night or two more.
Annja sat on the bed a few minutes later, freshly showered and wearing a white, fluffy robe and a towel wrapped around her hair. With the dig winding down, she didn't have much holding her in New Mexico. Except, she felt a strong sense developing that she needed to stay. She wasn't sure why, but she and her companions had seen that terrifying flying thing not 2 hours earlier. The fear it inspired still seemed to echo in her soul like the tolling of a distant bell. And now this Santo Niño seemed to be resurrecting the classic vanishing hitchhiker urban legend. Oddity seemed to be converging on this small area of New Mexico, which was plenty peculiar to start with. And Anya's life was all about strangeness, it seemed. She opened her laptop and got to digging. A few Google search words, black giant bird anomalous, took her quickly to a site for a movie from a few years back called The Mothman Prophecies. She hadn't seen it. She had little interest in supernatural stuff. That site led her to a listing for an ostensibly nonfiction book by a man named John A. Keel, and then to a scattering of paranormal and cryptozoology sites. It was all the usual huffing and conspiracy theorizing. She skimmed for a while, and then moved on to other subjects. A quick check of Snopes.com.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.